There's something that has been bugging me in the past few months. So, in the past few months, I had several virtual meeting sessions with clients who complained to me how Scrum didn't work at their company, and they asked me how to fix it. But when I listen closely to what people say during the virtual meeting session, I don't sense the existence of a Scrum team in the company. Now, if your workplace claims to be using Scrum, are you sure there is a Scrum team in there? How would you know though? How would you know those people are not working like a feature factory? Yep. So in general, people who work in a feature factory are what you just saw in the previous illustration. And for those of you who have been following this channel for a while, you probably already heard me mention the term feature factory in some videos on this channel. I will continue mentioning the term feature factory and refer to this video in my future videos. So I have strived to get people out of feature factories for many years because I think feature factories are limiting humans' potential. So in today's video, I would like to share with you what I have done in the past 3 weeks. I have asked people on LinkedIn, what are the indicators of a feature factory? So in today's video, you will see the collective intelligence from several Scrum practitioners who are based in many different locations around the world. I have personally learned a lot from them. If you're curious to hear their opinions, don't go anywhere because I'll be back right after this one. Hey, what's good this week, awesome people? Welcome back to my channel. And for those of you who are new to my channel, my name is Joshua Partorigi. Welcome to the community of passionate changemakers. So let's continue our discussion on feature factories. Feature factories are one of the manifestations of misunderstanding about Scrum. In general, here is an illustration of how a feature factory emerged in a workplace. Meet John Doe. John Doe worked for Acme Corporation. John Doe read several blog posts and watched several YouTube videos on Scrum from unreliable sources. Even though these resources are unreliable, it confirmed his bias. That's why John Doe loved it. Afterwards, John Doe concluded Scrum as a staggered mini waterfall. John Doe introduced staggered mini waterfall as Scrum to everyone in the company. Every function from user experience, design, engineering, quality assurance, and DevOps have their own sprints. The scope for every sprint is fixed. It's non-negotiable. Acme Corporation wanted to be more agile like every other company on planet Earth. Acme Corporation hired Jennifer, who worked for a top-notch management consulting company, as an external agile coach to help John Doe for the agile transformation. Everyone at Acme Corporation is forced to use Scrum. Jennifer affirmed to everyone that what John introduced is definitely Scrum. Because Jennifer is the external agile coach, everyone believed Jennifer. However, everyone wondered why Scrum is so much worse than the previous methods they used. Everyone felt they were like a feature factory. Because of this, many people in the company, mainly the software engineers, hated this fake Scrum with passion. Some of them even wrote articles about how horrible Scrum is for software engineers. These articles went viral on the internet. It turns out there are so many software engineers on planet Earth who hate this fake Scrum for the same reason. After you watched that illustration, now let's hear several more opinions from other Scrum practitioners about the indicators of a feature factory. People who work in a feature factory don't have shared values. They're just moving in motion and mostly focus on the mechanics of Scrum. Scrum teams, though, share the same values, which is the Scrum values. I've already made a video on Scrum values. If you haven't watched that video, you can click the link up here to watch the video first. Nguyen Duy Tuan, who is based in Vietnam, said that in a feature factory, people just want to do simple tasks so they can accomplish their tasks and move on to the next step in the development process as quickly as possible. He also said that in a feature factory, people don't see how the system works completely. And in a feature factory, it's hard for people to generate innovations and to take risk. Olga Hoxha, who is currently based in Auckland, New Zealand, said that in a feature factory, people ensure their sprint backlog is full to maximum capacity. The output metrics are tracked and measured. People are just building stuff without any idea of where and why they are going. Thank you, Nguyen and Olga, for your inputs. I agree with both of you. To develop valuable products, risk-taking and innovation is needed. And innovation requires slack time. But like both of you said, in a feature factory, there is no slack time for innovation. People are just focused on being busy. Not only do people who work like a feature factory don't have shared values, they also don't have shared accountability. In a feature factory, people are just focused and only care about optimizing their individual and department key performance indicators, or KPI. According to Scrum Guide, the Scrum team has a shared accountability, which is to create a valuable, useful increment every sprint. Christoph Steinlechner, who is based in Berlin, Germany, said that in a feature factory, there's nearly no cross-functional collaboration, but only handover between functional roles. I would like to add inputs on top of what Christoph said here. In a feature factory, each function will have their own separate functional sprints. So for example, UX people have their own dedicated UX sprint, and once they're done with their sprints, they will toss over their work to the engineers who work in their own engineering sprints. Engineers will then toss their work to people in quality assurance who also have their own dedicated QA or testing sprints. And the current trend right now, the end of the handover, there is DevOps sprints. I know there's no such thing as DevOps team or DevOps engineers, but in a feature factory, this kind of ridiculousness exists. Even more interesting, Michelle Salk, who is based in Germany, said that in a feature factory, the definition and the shaping of a feature is done by 1 hour by one person and sent to everyone in the company by email. Thank you, Christoph. Thank you, Michelle, for your inputs. I appreciate you. And thirdly, folks, people who work like a feature factory, they don't work towards the same goal and the same vision. As written on Scrum Guide, Scrum teams work on the same product goal and the same sprint goal. I've already made a video on the product goal. If you haven't watched that video, you can click the link up here to watch that video. Luca Ippoliti, who is currently based in the Netherlands, said that in a feature factory, people are not seeing the possibility to combine different features into one unique product that ensures a consistent value, because in a feature factory, there is a lack of product lens in terms of product vision, roadmap, ownership, design, and overall value for the customer and for the company. And on top of what Luca said, Bruno Moreira, who is currently based in Vienna, Austria, thinks that very often the input from the customer is not enough to deliver products that are valuable today and will continue to be valuable tomorrow. But in a feature factory, people will just do whatever the customer told them to do. Very interesting thoughts there. Thank you, Luca and Bruno. I learned something from both of you. John Clopton, who is currently based in St. Louis, United States of America, said that in a feature factory, there's no connection between the development work and the goals of the business. Features are generally a list of technical specifications gathered in detail upfront. The Scrum developers in this case are then only expected to execute based on the defined specification. And on top of what John said, Sushan, who is currently based in Armenia, said something quite similar. She said that in a feature factory, developers are treated only as code writers. In a feature factory, any product-related suggestion from the developers are not heard and not taken into account. Well, that's quite understandable, because in a feature factory, people are just resources or a cog in a machine. Thank you, Luca, Bruno, John, and Sushan for your input. I learned something from all of you. And lastly, folks, people who work in a feature factory are more focused on delivering as many outputs as possible rather than the outcome of the product. They use metrics like throughput or even arbitrary metrics like velocity as the indicators of success. And quite often, the amount of velocity people need to achieve is predefined by someone else up there who's not even part of the Scrum team. In a worst case scenario, the velocity that needs to be achieved is defined by the product owner. And in a horrible scenario, the velocity that needs to be achieved is defined by the Scrum Master. If you're a Scrum Master, I hope you're not doing this to the Scrum team. Scrum teams use outcome metrics as indicators of success. I've already made a video on outcome metrics. If you haven't watched that video, you can click the link up here to watch the video first. Matthew Hall, who is based in Canada, he said that people working like a feature factory don't continuously test the hypothesis whether the features they develop are really valuable to the users. Matthew also adds that people who work like feature factories are not doing continuous measurement and continuous improvement to adapt to user needs. Very interesting. I really like the idea of continuous measurement, and I think that's the whole point of sprinting, to inspect and to adapt. We should be inspecting the outcome metrics every sprint. And Martin Dalmeen, who is based in Netherlands, said that in a feature factory, features are only built and then forgotten. Features that are no longer valuable never get removed. And I think this is because the outcome of those features are not being measured. So how would these people know which feature should be removed if the outcome of each features are not being measured? Thank you, Martin. I really like the idea of removing features there. I think all product owners should have the habit of removing low-value features, not only adding items to the product backlog. Thank you, Martin. Thank you, Matthew, for your inputs. I learned something from you both. That is all for today, folks. And before I end today's video, I would like to specially thank Martin Dalmeen, Matthew Hall, Nguyen Duy Tuan, Luca Ippoliti, John Clapton, Bruno Moreira, Michelle Salk, Christoph Steinlechner, Olga Hoxha, and Sushan for their contribution and inputs on my mini survey on LinkedIn. And of course, I wouldn't dismiss everyone else who has contributed to my mini survey on LinkedIn. You folks are super awesome. I learned a lot from all of you. I had great fun when making this video you're currently watching right now. And I would also like to thank you. Yes, you, for investing your time watching today's video. I really appreciate it, folks. After watching today's video, hopefully you will become aware that there are many workplaces out there who claim to be using Scrum, but people in there are working like feature factories. And after you heard some of the opinions from other Scrum practitioners in this video, what's your opinion? Are there any other attributes of feature factories that were not mentioned in this video? Leave a comment down below. Please share today's video on your social media account and smash that like button down below, because by doing so, this video will reach more audience across the globe and you may save one soul from a feature factory. Never underestimate how saving one soul from a feature factory can make a big difference in the world we live in right now. Don't forget to subscribe to my channel, as I will upload more videos in the future that can help you improve your Scrum team's effectiveness and also your organization agility. And for those of you who aspire to be an awesome Scrum Master, you can also subscribe to my podcast either on Spotify, Google Podcasts, or Apple Podcasts. You can search my podcast name using the keywords Think and Act Like a Scrum Master. And while you wait for my next YouTube video or my next podcast episode, you can click the thumbnails here to watch the other videos currently available on this channel. Until then, don't forget to stay safe and stay awesome.